particularly small group today, so consider yourself the select few, and I thank you very much for coming. I am very delighted to introduce you, if you haven't already met him, Chris O'Reilly. Chris O'Reilly works for ISS and is a university teaching fellow, and and is going to be telling us about the ways in which we might be able to incorporate digital objects into our learning and teaching spaces, particularly into WebLearn, and particularly how he might be able to help us. You don't have to do it all yourself.
Thank you. I sort of know some people, probably not others. Well, I've probably seen you around, I guess. A bit about myself first. Chris O'Reilly, ISS. Been working on the ISS for over 20 years, I started here when it was North London Poly, in the language centre. Even though I was employed by ISS, I was seconded there for many years, developing their language material. If anyone's on a language course here on the OLP and you've used EPACs, all that stuff is what I've done many years ago, which is all a bit out of date, but people are still using them, and it's good. But about 5 years ago, they moved me to a central service and decided that the service I could give is university-wide. And it's changed a lot, really. Not that my department quite get that, but when I was before doing the work, it was in Flash, a lot of it, the interactive stuff, a lot of recordings, obviously, a bit of audio. And of course, people are using Flash less and less if anyone's aware of that, because of, you can't use it on iPad or iPhone. And so that has people using it a lot. However, it's still good stuff and it is used in certain parts. And so it's still used, actually. Like, people say it's finished, but it isn't quite. HTML 5 is supposed to be taken over and different variations of it. And it is a bit, it's still a bit behind, in my opinion. There you go. But that's some material I use to create stuff. But on the side of that, having come from a photography video story background, I do some of that work here as well. But all my work is geared for learning and teaching. I'm going to do it publicly for the university, or some classroom capture video, or events and stuff like that. It's purely general. So that's a bit about me. What I'm going to do today, just quickly show you a few projects I've been working on, a couple of projects that exist. You might be able to use or use for your students as well, if they can know things sort of going on in different areas, because I work with different departments, and then some other ideas. When Cheryl asked me to do this, I didn't have a clue really what to do, because I don't really talk about myself. But this is the email you sent out, and I thought it was okay, so I'm actually going to work on this. Happy ways to address people's questions and students, I'll show a bit about that, a bit about one moment, and do more of that, I guess. Graphics, information, so I'll mention about 30 things, and maybe afterwards, so I'm not going to spend all day doing this, just a 5-10 minute chat about ideas you might have or things that you might want to do. If I can give advice, great. If I can help also, pretty good as well. So I'll start with the first one. When I said just now that I do mainly learning and teaching, that has changed a bit. There's a lot more professional service departments that come to me for help. And one of them is student services. I do quite a bit for student services. And they wanted something, which is how it sort of works at country. So we let our students keep on asking us questions. And so we put up frequently asked questions list. And the problem is students don't really read it. If they do read it, they don't know if it's related to them. So I said, well, why don't we do it? Find someone really nice to talk to, do a head and shoulders video. And there's a list of these, but I'll just show you. It's quite simple. The guy was really good. He didn't read from a script. He knew what he was doing. And there's loads of these. I don't know if you've seen any of these. That should be fine.
The advice, information and funding service at London Metropolitan University should always be your first port of call when you're looking for financial advice. Our offices are based at both Holloway and Aldgate and are usually open from 9 o'clock in the morning till 4 o'clock.
Okay, so this is Vic and he works for student services. Think about this, they're very short, they're about a minute, not much more. I think that's sort of the span that students would need for information. Education clips as well, I think something like that, quite good, little pockets. Well, she might show something of those. But there's also, some if it's instructional, of course that's going to be as long as you want it to be. That's slightly different for students when you get more engaged in it. So I just filmed this over there, they had their script. We knocked off about 40 of these. They're all up on a separate website. And so students just click on those questions now, and each video appears so they can watch it. The student feedback's pretty good, they think it's more personal and stuff like that. So that's just an example. So I just filmed that, went with the staff, and I do quite a variety of it. This is another one, I'll do it quickly. It's Debbie Orman, who works for the early childhood. And they've got a lot of distance learning courses. and they want to really communicate better with the staff, we talked about, but they in fact do a lot of work for early childhood, and this is just one, they want to get their students to understand parts of web learning more. So we just showed this in the learning centre. Shall I bit this, because this one's a bit more interesting.
Okay, I'm going to be talking to you about how to navigate your way through your online materials that you can find on WebLearn. And when you go into WebLearn, you'll get a list of all the modules that you're registered for. I've obviously got lots because I'm registered for lots of modules, but you'll probably only have two or three. So I'm going to click on one of these now, Understanding Play. And when you use the left-hand button, double-click, and you'll come straight in to your WebLearn module. So Understanding Play. And as you...
But you can see this one's a lot longer, it's more instructional, more informative. Well, I'm just showing us how we've done this, and I know there's a lot of other people doing their own recordings, there's different people using different techniques, different skills, blah, blah, blah. This one, we just talked, I know exactly what I filmed about five staff that day in the learning centre. They sat down on my laptop, I recorded this on screen using Camtasia while I was filming at the same time. So when I came to edit it, it was really easy. I just put two layers on top and I cut the bits that I wanted to see the screen, just dropped the bits down. It was very quick editing for me, which is what I did as well. So for me to shoot something like that was really quick. And for the results, I mean, it takes a bit of planning, so it's a bit of planning on their part what I wanted. But they've got quite a lot of these videos for their students. So when they're doing business learning courses, they feel it's really targeted to them. That's a really good point. Does anyone do anything like this? Oh, you do? Okay. How do you film your sessions? Do you do it yourself or do you get someone to do it?
John. John does it. John Leckham does it.
You couldn't find me. Okay.
But I also have students. I also have something called student-teacher partnership.
Okay.
I work with the students to actually develop different materials.
Okay.
And my students last year, hopefully this year, we might get some money to do it better than that. But they run it on their iPhones.
Okay. That's so, interesting.
But then because we had a much better. Skilled student last year, he was an expert in media, that's what, how he earned his money while he was studying science course.
Yeah.
So he was editing for us as well. But mainly John
does it. Okay. Your situation is that?
Actually, I've just used Camtasia.
Okay, you have the screen capture and stuff, which is really good actually.
Yeah.
Got a decent microphone, it works really well. That's key, I think. Yes, there's a lot of variety. There's a lot of people doing different things, struggling to do things sometimes, otherwise it's they're available and to ask. I'm certainly always available to give advice on any of this stuff. And if it's a bigger project or something to get involved with, I can also help you out with that if you like. But I'll show a few more other things just to vary this a little bit. It's not just the video stuff. So if I go to this one, there's loads of projects. This is a project I'll show you. You might have seen this. This is a game for finance, students' finance. And I've done some animations and filmed them, and you've probably seen some of these, I think you might have done. So I've just done this, I'll just show you quickly, because this is a big project, it took about a year. Okay. Well, I've done a few of these now, and once you've done the first few, it's not so bad. It all depends on the script. I get the script from the start, and then I go for it.
As a student, you may be tempted to borrow money if you are struggling to make ends meet. But before you do this, have you considered ways to maximise your income? You may be able to find a part-time job that fits in with your studies. For example, you can check out the London Met Jobs Fair, the job shop for part-time or temporary work. If you have children, you may be able to increase your income from means-tested state benefits. However, if you decide to borrow money in addition to your student loan, then it's best to use a student bank account with a free overdraft, provided you do not go over your allowed limit.
Anyway, that goes on for a bit. But you can see, what I'm trying to show is a variety of approaches we do, depending on content or what it is you want to do. And I'll show a bit more later on. But these work quite well, but they're very complicated to do. But I said about a year because it was about 6 months trying to get the script right. And once that's done by staff and they give it to me, then I'll think about it and then I'll do something. But actually, I can't draw that well. That is me, by the way, and I did film it and I did edit it. But I can't draw that well. It's cheating, really. I've done it all in Photoshop on a huge piece, and I got Steve the photographer to print it out about 5%. So if you see a shadow, you can almost see the next drawing I'm going to do. I'll just draw over. So you know, it's ways of getting around. Depends on what you want to do. That one's quite a bigger project. Something else? Question? Yeah.
Sorry. Would it be possible for you at all to develop a video or animation just to show staff and students how to navigate around the university website? Since they have developed this new version,
okay,
which everyone believes is rubbish,
okay,
that makes it very difficult. You have put a lot of effort in generating these, mm-hmm, and we don't have access to that.
Okay.
That's a shame.
So it's how students...
How to navigate. I work here, and I still can't find the information that I could easily find, okay, and search through the old version of the,
okay,
website, university website. Now this is just...
Okay. And do your students complain a bit about that?
Yeah, they do.
Does anyone else have that issue?
Very big photos.
Yeah.
This kind of...
okay.
I mean, it used to be you could put it on the search engine,
exactly,
of the university website, something. I can give you a simple example, PDP, Person Development Portfolios. You would put it in there, and you would actually, it would actually bring you,
okay,
everything relating to PDP. I did try that last year, I mean, at the beginning of the year, and it didn't work. So what I had to do is actually I got a link from PISA. And if I had the link, when you click on the link, it goes there. But if you don't have the link, it's really difficult to find things
stuff
on the web page. Very difficult.
Okay.
And we are having difficulties, let alone the students.
Okay, so there seems to be two issues there for me. One is stuff that you can't find through search, and that might be a technical issue, that's down to the site people. But actually using it, we could do something about that. But before I just jump in and start doing something like that, I'd have to get the okay from my department and probably marketing to make sure they agree that what you are saying is right. And this is a generic resource we could probably do.
I mean, I can tell you an example from this summer. From this summer, we had John Cass scholarships available.
Okay. Yeah.
It was put in the website, yes, that's true, but most of the students who turn up, the first workshop, not many students turn up. The second workshop, they turn up because I actually sent the student via email the link to the site.
So that's a difficult thing.
Very difficult. So the student couldn't find it, definitely. I know for sure. That's why they couldn't turn up.
What was your...
Sorry. My similar thing, I don't know whether again a similar thing, you might maybe not want to use at all, maybe it's already been dealt with, but in a sort of navigational thing, is there some sort of, I don't know, do students still find difficulty finding places? They always have done historically.
Around the building.
I know that ISS for many years tried to develop an app, but apparently it's very difficult.
I was aware of that.
Is there anything like I'm a BEL, I don't know, is there anything that...
Or just shown in there. I don't know. I know there was a phone app a while ago that I tried to do, and then they changed the app so it didn't quite work. Oh, it doesn't go to that
is
level.
Is there anyone who could... I don't know, I'm just off the top of my head.
No, I think it's a good idea. I think what the technology we've got...
I want to go to the red section.
Yeah, well, I think the technology we've got, we should be able to do something like that. You know,
I think there's a red section.
That's probably a bit out of my remit, to be honest, that side of it. But I do think that you're not the only person to say that. I think a lot of people would agree. I'm just going to come back to the website bit, because I think that this is an issue. And I think it needs to be addressed in the right way to the right people. And I can certainly be involved in that. Whether they want marketing, want me to do anything about it, I don't know, but I can sort of talk about it with them. I think the idea is because of the website, so how it would use, you'd like to think the people that have done the website, oh, it's all signed off, or whatever they're doing, there should be an easy way. I mean, you could do it in Camtasia. I mean, you could play around for 5 minutes just to give people an idea of its limitations and what it can do, and I think that could be quite easy. I can certainly ask questions my end. I think that's a good point, and I'd say there's a lot of interest in that, and I'm sure you guys are not the only people to say that. So maybe we could think about that. So that's what I will take away from here today. And I think that's more of a generic thing. Do you address this anywhere else? Have you got another forum to take that to about the website? No? Okay. I will do something my end. I'm not sure I'm the right person to do it, but I might speak to some people to do it. But I don't think it's a difficult thing to do, not from the technical side of what we're talking about here. Okay, just a couple more things. One is about Chris, Department of Student Services, contacted me about getting noticed. They were told that they had to get more students to do, get more jobs and potentially improve their outlook to get jobs, and their page is all a bit text heavy, so I started to do this. It isn't finished and we're still working on it, sadly, but this just gives you an idea. It's an infographic. Anyone use infographics or seen infographics? This is the page, because I have to show, because it's actually the idea of infographics is very limited colours, 3 or 4, very dynamic, and you have about 1 to 6 or 10 key items to students or someone, whatever it is, where it's a topic, a subject, or idea. It's brought down and you see what you're supposed to do. It's very short and sweet, if you like, very impacty, if that makes any sense, as an English word. So one there's contacting them, what they should be doing, research or career options, there's links like this. Just, you can see what I mean about the graphic side of it. So it's just about impact, and here you would go to links to other pages. It's just trying to jazz it up, ask yourself questions. There's software online that you can do this for free, and it's you can play around, type in infographics, for infographics design, and in Google it will give you 2 or 3 that say these are free and you can try them out. This one I actually done from scratch using Photoshop. And create a page on it. But this is, as you can see, this isn't finished. We've got ideas, and they're trying to give me, there's my little colour code, you know, this is really basic at the moment. We did shoot some videos of the students and employers asking what they wanted from our students, and they will feature in this nice little TV. There's just stuff like that. So that's what an infographic is, and it's quite good for impact information, generally. Question?
Like a video to, say, promote a course. Who do we go and see?
If you're
promoting a course? Yes. Who do we go
and see? Or set up a video or animation? If you're promoting a part of the course, the video, whatever you're going to create, is going to go on the front pages of our university site, and that would all go through marketing. You would need to contact marketing. Sadly, I also know that the guy that does that recently left, the film guy, the producer, Mark, sadly he's gone somewhere else, but we are supposed to be recruiting someone because he had a list of filming loads of lectures and departments and areas and classes that are all going to be relating. There's a lot of them done already, and I think they're slowly going up. But I know they haven't covered them all, but if there's something about your course, you can really contact marketing and ask them what is promoting.
And what about, teaching materials? If you like to show what's happening lab or practicals that students can go back to for their study. Do we see that creating videos in those cases?
What would you actually be getting them to film them working or doing workshops for me?
Something like they're both, really.
Okay, yeah, email me.
Email me.
Hopefully that's on the email, they'll be up there. Speak to me. If I can't do it, I'd recommend who could. Oh, another way of doing it, but I get the feeling that's sort of my area.
I've got a grand total of 50 student presentations that have taken place in 9 weeks. I won't film them. So I can assess them. I don't trust my colleagues like Dr. White to Mark properly. So I wanted them to second Mark before them, by looking at them more afterwards.
Okay.
So it's good, I guess, for external to see what they do too. What's the best way of doing that?
I'd go for the media department first. Really? And foremost. One, they've got the equipment. Two, they've got a lot more staff.
They've got 3 people who can film simultaneously.
Is that what you'd want? Then contact John Luckin.
Yeah.
Do you know John Luckin?
John
Luckin.
Because just Camtasia would be easy.
With Camtasia, you're not getting the student. I don't
want to see the student. I want to hear their voice and see what they're saying.
Okay, so it's more audio. Okay. John does a lot of that for events. He'll set up 2 or 3 camera systems with audio recording and stuff like that. If that's relevant to that, it's a good. No questions.
Related to my question, say we contact you, is there like any admin involved in terms of budgeting and in
There's no funds. If this is something you want to do for your course and you want to put in time into it to write something or develop something, get your students to do workshops, then I would talk to you. And if it's something I thought that I could cover and it's good for your class, your students at the university, I would encourage it and I will help.
So it's straightforward.
So we don't need to pay you.
Don't need to pay me. So the problem with the services is, for me anyway, I'm telling more and more people as it goes on, more stuff's getting promoted and more work's coming in. So this is more of a trial and error for me. But I always try and encourage new projects, really. I think new projects are the way to go, and we'll share that and move it through a bit better. And different ones as well. I haven't done it yet, but I went to a conference recently where people were talking about, there was a developer guy somewhere, I think it was in Southampton University, and he's getting in the, and he's got, they've got a huge lot of first years doing sort of sewing. They've got these huge professional sewing machines in abundance. And he said staff, students come in, they all sit there, almost like a science centre, there's loads of stuff, and they forget the basic stuff. So what they've managed to do, instead of asking questions, they put QR codes on everything. Does anyone know what QR code is? A QR code is like, I'll show you again in a minute, it's like a square box with loads of dots in it, you might have seen them around. Okay. And what that does, it tends to, if you've got a smartphone, you get an app, you can click on it, and it will take you to that website. And what they've done, they made mini films, no more than a minute each, mainly audio, but a bit of a visual, so people, they're just smartphone, that's what I should be doing. And they're doing that more and more, and I thought that might be a good idea for our science centre here, because students coming in, they start to do the same thing, they're asking the same questions. Let's just put different colour QR codes on different areas, and so it'll say, this might be mechanical, this might be a theory you need to know, this might be something else, so students can look at it. I haven't started that one yet, but that's a very reasonably easy project to do, and I think it could really render some good, quick results. And that's what I'm really at, really, getting good, quick results for our students.
Yeah. It's kind of disagreement between the colleagues of allowing students to use their mobile phone in the super lab.
Oh, there is.
Well, I'm...
That would have to be my first question if I speak to anyone. I mean, I won't just do these things. I'll email someone and I'll say, is this a reasonable idea? Are you doing this already? Is it something you thought about? And if that is the case, and if they're half interested, we will talk
but
about
this
that.
This is a great idea.
I think they're using it more and more for different things. I'll show you something else.
Can I ask another question?
Go on.
Maybe out of the context of what we were talking. Am I right to assume that we were told that we could start recording the lectures while we do it?
This is a good question. I'm not fully aware how the situation is at the moment. I know there's stuff that's been installed, and I know there's been some... You're talking about Camtasia filming in the
first lecture that I gave, there was kind of message on the screen, do you want to record it?
Okay. I think that's it.
I wasn't sure what to do, and
okay.
Then that disappeared. There's nothing happening anymore.
Okay.
Sorry.
No worries, that is Camtasia Relay. I have been talking to Celt about where we've got to. They have been chasing colleagues in ISS who aren't Chris, some other people. It is installed at the minute that questions are around where is the recording going, how secure is it, how do you then upload it. I am still chasing the answers to those questions, and once we have those answers from ISS, I will be getting Celt to do a quick guide.
I think that's really the key thing. I think the issue at the moment is they've tried it, and they want a better infrastructure. From what I'm aware, they're getting another couple of servers to back it up, because once it takes up, it can take up quite quickly. And I think the idea is, once it's established, once it's rolling out, there would be some workshops and some training given. At the moment, I think they thought, we've got this going, it looks like it's working. Put it on a few machines, let people do it. And I think that was the wrong way to do it personally. You know, you should give instructional. Once it's working and it's tested, then let people know and run these workshops. And I get the feeling that's probably why they've gone back one step to go forward in a different direction. So not just yet, but I'm sure everyone will know.
You're using Camtasia Relay, are you, or are you using the full version of Camtasia?
Screen capture you're using, I'm guessing.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
I don't know how my time's going, I'm just going to babble for a couple more. It's time.
It's nearly 25 past.
Oh, that's all right then.
Yeah.
Sorry, guys. You've got a bit more, haven't we? Okay, these are projects I've done in consultation with Celt. I call them Celt, don't know what everyone else calls them. Hopefully, you know two of these. No, probably no one. Does anyone look at Study Hub?
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone know what this is?
Yeah. No.
Okay, no. Take five. Anyone know this?
No.
Okay. This one you probably don't. This Study Hub is a student-based site. It's resources for about everything they need to know to be academic, really. I might show you the link. I'll put something up. And all I do is develop the site. I developed the website, but all the work comes from Celt. Sandra Sinfield and Tom Burns, with a lot of content lists and links elsewhere. It's about critical thinking. It's about writing your first essay. There's loads of information for students. All the students who go to WebLearn, there's a link to Study Hub. It goes straight for all their needs, really. It's supposed to be a one-stop shop for everything. Take 5 is a start version, almost. And if you go into the Student Study Hub, there'll be a link to this. And if you go into the Staff Study Hub, Take 5, there's a link to this. This one has just been loaded up. This one contains a blog. There's lots of information on there where you can go for resources and stuff you might need. But it also contains an up-to-date blog that's put up every week. And the idea is to get staff to contribute of ideas, thoughts, and to pass it around. So it's just in its infancy. That's the idea of Take 5. These ones, close to my heart, these ones, I really believe in these projects. Heroes and Villains was initially started by a student union who worked with Salt and then came to me. We built a wonderful site, which I'll talk about a little bit. This one is the one I started up with another colleague called Jim Pettywood from Salt. And Clued Up is geared up to help students understand more about digital literacies, not just about themselves and studying, but about how they have their image, their online presence, which is really important. And there's a lot of areas that are quite controversial about that. And that's what this site is geared at. And the way we've done this is we recruit digital student ambassadors. We've just started this, we've got 10, and the idea is we're doing workshops with them, and then they're going to go out and teach another 10 each. So we're trying to get that momentum going. We've put in a 20-20 bid for this. Further on, because I funded it initially out of some other funds. Hopefully that will take off. What I could do is, sorry, and I'll send all the links to these. I mean, I don't want to go for them actually now, but that's fine. Come back to this one, Heroes and Villains. It's about academic, I can't see that, but academic honesty and integrity website. It's a bit text heavy, hence we've got these wonderful little cartoons. The students talking about what they think cheating is, what they think referencing is, it's all about plagiarism. Why they might lose some marks, mainly accidentally. So it's a lot about how to be academic, what you should be doing when you're writing your academic essays. Loads of information here. These two, we publicised at Freshers this year. We had lots of interest for our students. We also give out some nice little cards. We've got Heroes and Villains. Here. And we give out little postcards. I should have broken these out. So there's a link on the back. Do have a look. Do direct your students to the site. It's free. There's a nice little set.
Do you want me to do that?
Yeah, is that alright? There's O4, but I keep getting mixed up. Which one have you got, that one? The A.
Yeah.
Okay. The idea is, can you use one of yours? It's a bit strange. You've got these hot cards, you probably can't see them properly there. But you've got that villain, he's got scissors and glue, so he's cut and pasted. Yeah, stuff like that. And this one is someone's sheep that's been caught, so he's got egg on his face. Okay. But you've got heroes now, and there's a lot more work to go here. There's at least another year's work to do this to build it up. So this is our take on this. Getting quite a lot of support from myself, and the students really took to this at Freshers, and we signed up hundreds of students for that. The next one, Clued Up. Just briefly down here, you probably can't see that at the back, but we've listed some icons on the website that students would probably use, but we're trying to get them to use these ones, and trying to give them a different thought. There's two videos under here, I might show one of them if I've got time, because it's actually very good. And the students like it. I've done a presentation of Clued Up at an Aldine conference earlier on this year, and the interest from other universities was huge, because other universities realise this is a big area, and they don't know how to address it, and I did we start to do this. And almost most of the universities are now using the videos we use for this, which is really good. And we're working now with UCL and LSC, and Kent, and Sussex, I think. Now, I think we're funding a bit further than this. But one of the things we did do, if I can just do this. Okay, just an example. Got some other cards. We used to give these out to the students. We've got 8 of these. Anyone see that? Does anyone know what they are? Does anyone know what this is? Anyone see this one?
Never.
Right. This isn't black, and it's not black. Just an example of people, sorry. Just so you can see.
Oh, yeah.
You might well use this, you might not have seen it. There's different ones if you want any more, and I've got about 8 of these, and this seems like... And the idea is to get students to think about what it is they're doing. So we've got things like LinkedIn, so everyone make sure the students know about LinkedIn and they give themselves a professional appearance online. Careful what they put on Facebook, that sort of stuff. Google Drive, so they know they've got storage here, stuff like that. All the information's on the back. Things called Digo. Has everyone heard of Digo? Okay. It's good if you're doing research or sharing work with others. It saves websites really well. It doesn't just save a bookmark, it captures the image of the page. So if it ever disappears, you can come back to it. It's all cloud-based. There's quite a few, actually. Anyway, so we've got all these little icons, and this is put up. And the other one was... Anyway, there's loads of it. And if you go onto the website, you'll see explanations of what they are. Okay. So anyway, so they're the two student projects. And if you've got the links then, do have a look. Do encourage your students to look at both of these. They're quite good. And everything links on the Study Hub. If you go to the Study Hub, you'll find these. And you'll also find a link to Library Matters as well. It touches on similar areas. We talked about classroom projects, professional service to help students and that. I also do other projects, not as many now, which is a shame. But this is what I've done with a business school, and I've got some external funding from Vicky Moss to do this site for our students and about some calls. So I developed this to show you a little bit of it, I won't bore you with it. But again, this was done in Flash, so hopefully this will work.
Hello and welcome to this learning resource. We hope...
Anyway, we've got a nice resource. We've done it with our students. There's 5 sections. It goes on a bit, but some of it's quite good. There's questions in each section. This is our students doing a tour, so we film them. So yeah, I've developed this in Flash, which isn't used a lot, but not on the iPhone, but it's still used for stuff like this because it's great. Okay. Done all the filming, done the editing, done the content like this. This is actually now housed at
our St. Paul's Cathedral's website. We're joining Northern England, 2 lovely students on their first visit to St. Paul's Cathedral.
And a few other
stuff. Just enter the cathedral from the west front, climbing up the famous steps.
The idea for us is there was a considerable amount of funding given to the business school, of which I think ISS got a little bit, which is okay because we have the tour to do. But if you get external funding, you want to build a project with people you know, you might have organisations outside, you want to do something in partnership, we can do something like this as well. Yeah, just bear it in mind. The university, be grateful for the money coming in, and if it sort of promotes the university in a positive light, we'll support it. Yeah. Close that one down. That's good, that worked actually. I'm also going to say about stuff that's actually online. Vimeo and YouTube stuff, you probably know about this anyway. That's something I used recently in a workshop, which looks a bit strange. If anyone's not familiar with it, I used it because it's the Charlie Chaplin speech from The Great Dictator, which I think is quite emotional. Has anyone ever seen this? Has anyone there? Seen it? It's quite good. The whole film's a bit of a farce, but the end of it is done purely about humanity, really, and about being together and helping. And students are quite surprised at that, because they see that it's really funny. This one I show a lot as well, workshops. If I'm getting students to work and I film them, make them think differently. This is called, this is water, I think it's This is Water. Have anyone seen this video? Okay, very inspirational. David Foster Wallace done a talk in America, who sadly passed away, but a company animated the first part there. That's very good. And this one, I'm just going to show you briefly, is the one from Clued Up website. If I can get that to work. Maybe it won't.
You just have to look around to see that technology is everywhere. You just can't get away from it, whether you're in the library, on the bus, at home, or even in a lecture. We're starting to live more and more of our lives online.
It's usually a couple of hours, 3 to 5 hours or so.
8 hours or more?
7 to 8 hours.
I think about 2 hours.
Okay.
5 hours, okay. I think.
I would say about 6-7 hours.
4 hours, Facebook, Instagram. Yeah, something like that, yeah.
When I'm asleep.
I'm eating.
No, I can do it while I'm eating.
Yeah, that's true.
There's a very good chance that you're one of over 1 billion people around the world using Facebook or on Twitter, using Instagram or on YouTube. It's second nature to share photos, stories, videos and information online with friends and others, and maybe anyone else who might be looking. But the amount of time we spend on the internet and what we do when we're there means it's more important than ever to think about our own digital identity.
Okay, that can come in a bit. Every time we show this at conferences on to our own students, it goes on a bit and it talks, a lot of it's backtracked as well, so the students talk about their experiences and issues they might have had, and someone say, oh, I don't do anything about my privacy settings, and then someone else says, no one sees my stuff. In fact, they've got two names for two different accounts. And all. You know, so it's quite interesting. The students don't get really a chance to talk about this. It's a key part of what they're hoping to take out of them, I think, when they leave. So this is on the Pooled Up website. There's another one about learning digitally online as well, which is really good. It's about how to reference online. It's about how to use apps to reference properly, where you can just barcode, scan the book, and it sends a citation and a reference to your email, and you can click back in. All these little sort of tips are on the website. And every time I've got a 5 minute break with students, I've just shown that when they're a bit bored, and the next bit they're writing all day. So yeah, there's stuff out there which we need to know about, and we can tell them as well. So that's sort of it. So my last slide really is this, which you might have seen before. I've retyped it because I couldn't read the original graphic I had. And I really like it because I deal with technology a lot. I deal with film and deal with things, but it isn't the answer, not necessary. And I love the idea, you know, everyone's doing like quizzes or blogs or words, animations, but what we want to do is this. And this is just the tool for this, and we know this. But we need to put that over to the students as well. The students will make, you know, they'll make their videos, they'll do this stuff. But what are they learning? What are we getting to learn from it is key, really. So I quite like that. It's a tool, not a learning outcome. Of course, it is. So that's me, really.